Dear students, in the previous lecture, we talked about the plankton and today we shall be talking about the nekton. Before proceeding, it is my request to you all to like and subscribe my channel. First of all, we shall be knowing what nekton means. The term is derived from a Greek word which means to swim. The term nekton is used for those organisms which swim freely in water and possess efficiency of locomotion, which enables to be more or less independent of drifting effects of water movements. So the only difference between the nekton and the plankton is that plankton are at the mercy of the water current. They are unable to swim against the current of the water. And here in this very category of the nekton, all the nekton have the ability or efficiency of the locomotion. The term nekton was proposed by German biologist, that is Ernst Haeckel, in his article, that is Plankton-Studien, to differentiate between the active swimmers in a body of water and the passive organisms that are carried along by the current, that is plankton. As a guideline, nektonic organisms have high Reynolds number, which is greater than 1000 in the case of the nektons and less than 10 in the case of the planktonic organisms. Now, what is Reynolds number that we shall be discussing? However, some organisms can begin life as planktonic or as plankton and transition to the nekton later in the life, and sometimes making distinction difficult when attempting to classify certain plankton to nekton species as one or other. So for some species, they spend earlier part of their life as the plankton and they later change to the nekton in the adult stage. So the larvae are the planktons and the adults are the nektons. So it becomes difficult for those very taxonomists, for those very workers who have to classify. So for this reason, some biologists choose not to use this very term. Now, what is this very Reynolds number which I was talking about, this very Reynolds number, which is 1000, more than 1000 in the case of the nektonic organisms and less than 10 in case of planktonic organisms. So Reynolds number helps predict flow patterns in different flow situations. The concept was introduced by the George Stokes in 1851. This very concept was proposed by George Stokes in 1851. But this very Reynolds number was named or coined by Arnold Summerfield. Arnold Summerfield in 1908. Now, he coined this very term, that is Reynolds number, after Osborne Reynolds. Osborne Reynolds, who lived from 1842 to 1912 and who popularized its use in 1883. So the concept was given by the George Stokes in 1851, and Arnold Summerfield used the term Reynolds number, and only after Osborne Reynolds, who popularized its use in 1883. Now we shall be talking about the nekton, that what nektons actually are. We say that nektons are the active swimmers that use diverse means to propel themselves through the water. So they have the ability to move against the current of the water. They have the well power of the locomotion. And some species swim using fins, tails or flippers. And other species such as cephalopods, they move by shooting out the jets of the water, which we call as jet propulsion. And thirdly, nektonic species include fish, octopus, sea turtles, whales, seals, penguins, and many other whosoever live in water or whosoever are in contact with water and have the power of locomotion. Now talking about the types, that is the types of the nekton. There are three types of the nekton. We mostly classify them into three types. That is, we categorize them into chordates, we categorize them as mollusks and arthropods. So these are the three major types. And the majority of the nekton species, they consist of carnivorous animals which find their prey over a wide area. Now, in case of the chordates, we do have the fishes, we do have the reptiles, we do have the seabirds, we do have the mammals. And in the case of invertebrata, we do have the other two categories, that is the mollusca and arthropoda, wherein we do have the octopus, we do have the squids, we do have the sepia, we do have the loligo-like organisms which are not having the, you can say, vertebral column. But they have the good power of the locomotion. We categorize them as the invertebrate nekton. Now, if we talk about the feeding, that what matter they feed upon. Many nektonic species eat high in the food chain. That is, they are at the higher trophic level. Although there are plankton eating species, for example, fish, and herbivorous species such as sea turtles, in addition to carnivorous ones such as seals, killer whales. So in the it depends upon the zone they live. So in the aphotic zone, there are only heterotrophic organisms that are supported mostly by the organic material that rains down from the euphotic environment above. So these animals live in darkness, with the exception of the light producing animals, that is the bioluminescent organisms. So we do have many which are surface feeders, and which we do have many which are which live in the darkness, and they have to depend upon the food matter which rains from the above. Because in the lower zone there are no photoautotrophic organisms which can make feed. So they have to rely, and they are mostly carnivores and have to rely on whatsoever is falling from above. Now talking about their behavior, it is common for the sea creatures, especially animals living in the intermediate depths, to house luminescent bacteria within their tissues, which are able to produce light for communication, or as a lure to attract the prey, or to light their bottom surface to conceal their silhouette against the dimly lighted background from the above. So anglerfish, they are the deep sea predators that attract prey near their mouths by dangling a bioluminescent lure in front of their head. So the density of organisms in the deep sea is low. Because of this low density, a long period of time can pass between the meals or between the encounters within the opposite sex. So to deal with this very problem of infrequent meals, deep sea creatures are often gigantic as compared to the shallow water relatives. So large size allows for the storage of the food reserves that sustain the animals between meals. And predatory fish also have large mouth and stomachs that allow them to take full advantage of any meal regardless of the size. So these are the certain adaptations which some of the deep sea nektonic organisms have undergone so that they cannot die of the hunger. Now, when we talk about these very nekton, so in limnatic region of the inland waters, the nekton is composed almost entirely of the fishes in the case of the limnatic region. So the limnatic nekton may inhabit the whole of open water of a lake and down to its greatest depth. In contrast to the limnatic region, the littoral area is the zone of the greater nekton population. In addition to the fishes, young as well as mature, numerous free-swimming invertebrates occur mainly as insects. Vegetative zone, particularly the pondweed zone, contain largest nekton population. So we do have the the idea that the vegetative zone, particularly the pondweed vegetation, contain the largest nekton population. Major groups of the vertebrates, including fishes, amphibia, reptilia, aves, and mammalia, are more of the representative of the water and sometime free swimming in nature. And if we talk about the composition, the whole composition of the nekton in general, nekton comprises three phyla, which I talked earlier as well. That is the chordates and the non-chordates. Or we divide them into main three, that is chordata, mollusca, and arthropoda. But mollusk composition in the freshwater is very less as compared to the marine, or in the case of the nekton. So among the arthropods, the dominant group comprising insects and crustaceans are involved. However, the phylum chordata is the largest group of the nektonic community, mainly fishes, amphibians, reptiles, birds, and mammals. If we talk about their distribution depends on the following factors. There are various factors which mark an impact on the distribution of these very nektons. So their distribution can be because of the seasonal changes, physiological changes, that is the competition for the space, or the food availability and distribution. Their life cycle, that is young ones of the white fishes, they go to the surface for feeding, whereas adults, in their case, they come back to the bottom. Many of the adults inhabit the column water as well. And the formation of the local aggregations. Many of the nektons, they have the behavior of the formation of the aggregations. And many undergo the seasonal migration as well. And they also show the diurnal movement. So their distribution is also based on the diurnal movement. And reproductive cycle also plays an important role in their distribution. And presence and the absence of the shelter, oxygen distribution, and temperature conditions, they mark an impact on the distribution of the nektonic organisms. So, it has also been observed that the certain fishes select deeper, cooler waters, intermediate regions, and some select the upper strata. And such a distribution depends upon the season, physiological state of the fish, and the stage in the life, in their life history. And according to the Shelford 1913, if we talk about the Great Lakes, or if we take the conclusions from the fishes of the, or the nektonic organisms of the Great Lakes, there it was observed that the white fish exhibit the horizontal depth stratification and are arranged one above the other in their distribution. Whereas Cools, 1929, he claimed that this fish in the Great Lakes have shown the vertical distribution pattern. So in one study, it showed the horizontal depth stratification in the case of whitefish, whereas Cools, 1929, claimed that this very fish in the Great Lakes have the vertical distribution pattern as well. In some lakes, the species that regularly inhabit shallow water may be driven by the competition on the shoals or by absence of the shoals found in the deeper waters. For example, Lake Ontario. So in the Lake Ontario, it was also found that the competition also plays an important role in their distribution. In the Lake Nipigon, the species inhabiting the deeper waters, they are known to occur in shallow waters, and they were categorized as the Clopiformes, Alipini, Zenithicus, etc. But Johne, Nigripinis, and Key were found in the deeper waters. And the food of the Great Lake lake whitefishes seems to be secured from the plankton, and the immature fish come to the uppermost waters, giving them a vertical distribution from that of the mature stages. So fishes like that of the trout, that is the Cristivoma, Nemeyakush, and the Burbot, that is Lota Lota, they occur in the deeper waters. So this was all about the distribution, this was all about the Nekton, their types, distribution and the feeding, which we discussed in this very lecture. And in the next lecture, we shall be dealing with the periphyton for the in the subject of limnology. Thank you.